chance to greet all of you before I leave here. So let me just say, if you didn't witness it just a few minutes ago, out there in the Rose Garden, I met all the princesses for the our Cherry Blossom Festival here in Washington, including the Cherry Blossom Queen from Japan and our own Cory Cherry Blossom Queen, 56 princesses from all our states and territories. Now I have the pleasure of coming in and meeting a group like this. Mondays aren't supposed to be this nice. Well, anyway, on behalf of the United States, I welcome you and sincerely hope that your Eisenhower Fellowship in America increases understanding between us. President Eisenhower realized that there was a real need for a program to bring business and professional people to America to increase communication on a person-to-person basis. I think he understood very much that most of the trouble in the world comes when we are talking about each other instead of when we're talking to each other. So in today's troubled world, communication between us is of crucial importance. But knowing that I have a very limited time here, rather than me continuing to say anything other than how happy we are to have you all here, maybe at least for a minute or two till someone interrupts, some of you might have a question you'd like to ask. I'd be very happy to try and answer.
Well, now, our distinguished lady fellow, Britt, is going to answer your kind comments, Mr. President. She's over there.
Oh,
well.
Thank you for receiving us, Mr. President. We come from 22 different countries, as you probably know, in the world, and special fields of interests. We are very happy to be here and hope that our visit will be a contribution for better understanding and cooperation between the nations which we represent and the United States of America. Thank you again for seeing us, Mr. President.
My pleasure. Of course, when you come here, you realize that you're kind of visiting a little bit of your own country, because we Americans are very well aware that we came here from every corner of the world, if not ourselves, our parents or our ancestors came here. I know I have discovered since I've been here my own beginnings on my father's side from Ireland. He had been orphaned when he was a small boy, so I knew very little about his family until I got this job, and then somebody saw to it that I knew a great deal. In fact, it all began for the branch that came to America in Ballyporeen, where I'm happy to say that you know, sometimes holding this job, they name schools after you, or bridges after you, or airports. In Ballyporeen, the pub is named the Ronald Reagan. Well, is there a question or two? Don't be afraid of a lot of Americans who are not asking questions. Yes. Got a few questions for them.
I'm good. I've got some pictures, Mr. President, if you'd like to offer that opportunity.
Well, all right. I'll go over here to the door.
Job in Boston. What a winner that was.
That picture. Good
to see you, Craig.
Nice.
How are you, Jack?
How are you?
Thank you very much.
Great fun.
You know about Boston?
Short suit.
Well,
Margaret,
come in.
Thanks anymore.
Why don't you sit in the chair over there?
Like a Chinese design. Position of everyone's life. How fortunate I am. Private sector initiatives approach, because the issue of the homeless, which is our subject, really came to me through private sector leadership, namely one Susan Baker and her Citizens Committee. The Citizens Committee had been working in a number of cities, developing groups of people who would assist the homeless. But they wanted someone to help them on the federal side, cut through the red tape and make federal facilities available, and to provide whatever federal backup we could. And Susan asked me to do this. which I was delighted to do, because I'd been worried about these bag ladies and really the people on the streets, knowing that they are really a very, very desperate group of people. As a result of our meeting and the fact that she put her finger on an answer to what I knew was a problem, these homeless today, we've always had the homeless through the generations. They've in the past been alcoholics, drug users, but there's a new component in this group of homeless that is almost the most pathetic. These are the people who have been released from institutions, mental institutions, and have really they don't have the capacity to provide for their own shelter. They don't really know how to make federal programs work for them or use them. And they are simply out of the mainstream mentally. And you know, I remember all of your speeches on urban renewal, and you were so right when the country was wrong. A lot of these people would have been able to sleep in facilities that were in the urban renewal area, the old flop houses, places like that, were where they put their heads down. But with the loss of urban renewal and the development of deinstitutionalization as the way to treat mentally ill people without follow through and providing shelter for them, we have our department in Adam Ha, the Alcohol, Drug Abuse, and Mental Health Institute, has said, and they've had a very extensive professional scientific approach to the issue of the homeless, and they have found that 50% at least are among those who are mentally ill and don't have their bearings. So this is the component of the group that we're dealing with, and the question is how to deal with it. Now, if we had gone through the usual, if it had been a different era and a different time, Congress would have responded, passed a program, and it would have cost billions of dollars. They would have had all the red tape, EEOC, et cetera. But I think in your era, in your time, with the way that you do things, with the private sector approach, we were able to put together a response that was immediate and began to be effective in certain cities.
Mayor President Stewart.
Mr. President, glad to meet you. Since you have a good support.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President, Sister Jenna Rose, ready to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President John Curley, the
President. Hi, Mr. President. Nice to meet you.
Good to see you.
Thank you for seeing us.
President Sister Mary Rock.
Mr.
President Sister Marty McAtee, delighted to meet you. Mr. President, Sister Rita.
Good to see you.
Mr. President, Dean McAtee.
And Peter.
Mr. President.
Nice to see you.
And Bill Cox.
A pleasure, Mr. President.
And Judy Lindsay.
Well, I'm pleased to see you all. I had to wait here. I'm sorry for keeping you waiting here. But I only say my way of expiation that we were having a meeting with regard to the homeless and what we're going to be able to do about them. So, I know the work that you do. As a matter of fact, I know some of it firsthand, because for 8 weeks I laid in traction at St. John's Hospital in California, Santa Monica, there. I had a comminuted multiple fracture of my right back. Massive. The fundraiser just recently for St. John's. And as governor, I was on the board of trustees for a time there also. I want to thank you for all the help that you've been, and particularly with regard to the baby door regulations formulated.
We appreciate it.
I appreciated your help.
You know, I hope, Mr. President, that you'll accept this as an expression of our gratitude to you. You really take an extraordinary leadership role in life issues that are very important to us. And I think that people of the United States in dealing with the public policy issue of the allocation of resources and so on will increasingly more and more become involved in the kinds of issues that you've represented and done an advocate for. So we're very, very grateful to you for your life stands, for leadership, I think, on issues that are often very difficult and sometimes bring out very competing and unpleasant points of view.
We're grateful.
Mr. President, could we have one quick
look?
A rose between the thorns.
No.
up in the square. Thank you, sir.
And then could we do one with the two presidents and CEO?
Two Californians.
Yes, two Californians.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank
you very much.
And one of the things that I'm proudest of that we have going is this, seeing if we can't meld with the private sector in approaches that are better handled that way than the government trying to do.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Also know your disappointment in school prayer.
Then the Catholic Health Association.
They were
the worst against baby dough regulations.
Oh, yeah.
Apologize for the lateness.
I won't accept.
But we won't rush much at all. We have all the time we need.
Sure.
I don't know why you're here.
You've got a press conference.
Yes.
Press conference tonight.
Yeah.
You all set?
I think so. I have a hunch they're really out for blood, too. I think they're late until they can.
Let me tell you a strange experience I had yesterday. I got interested in, you know, what the hell's going on in the marketplace. So I called some of my old friends up on Wall Street. You know what they wanted to discuss? Ed Meese. No discussion of the deficit. No discussion of what are we going to do about taxes. Nothing of that nature. Are you figuring that out?
Well, when the press just day after day starts hammering us.